Now, guess who wrote this? When people talk about politics within the existing Westminster framework, I feel a dull thud in my stomach and my eyes involuntarily glaze, like when I'm conversing and the subject changes from me and moves on to another topic. The combination of distaste for mainstream politics and overweening vanity identifies it immediately as the work of Russell Brand, comedian, actor, and now it seems political theorist. Four. Is there no limit to the man's talents? He's now guest editor of the venerable left-wing magazine, The New Statesman. He wants a revolution, he says. Russell Brand, who are you to edit a political magazine?
Well, I just suppose like a person who's being politely asked by an attractive woman. I don't know what the typical criteria is. I don't know many people that edit political magazines. Boris, he used to do one, didn't he? So I'm a person with crazy hair, quite a good sense of humour. Don't know much about politics. I'm ideal.
But is it true you don't even vote?
Yeah, no, I don't vote.
Well, how do you have any authority to talk about politics then?
Well, I don't get my authority from this pre-existing paradigm, which is quite narrow and only serves a few people. I look elsewhere for alternatives that might be of service to humanity. Alternate means, alternate political systems.
They being?
Well, I've not invented it yet, Jeremy. I had to do a magazine last week. I've had a lot on my plate. But I say, but here's the thing that it shouldn't do. Shouldn't destroy the planet. Shouldn't create massive economic disparity. Shouldn't ignore the needs of the people. The burden of proof is on the people with the power, not people like doing a magazine.
How do you imagine the people get power?
Well, I imagine there are sort of hierarchical systems that have been preserved through
they
generations.
They get power by being voted in.
Well, you
that's
say that, Jeremy.
But you can't even be asked to vote.
It's quite a narrow prescriptive parameter that changes within the...
In a democracy, that's how it works.
Well, I don't think it's working very well, Jeremy, given that the planet is being destroyed, given that there is economic disparity of a huge degree. What are you saying? There's no alternative. There's no alternative.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm saying if you can't be asked to vote, why should we be asked to listen to your political point of view?
You don't have to listen to my political point of view, but it's not that I'm not voting out of apathy. I'm not voting out of absolute indifference and weariness and exhaustion from the lies, treachery, deceit of the political class that has been going on for generations now, and which has now reached fever pitch, where we have a disenfranchised, disillusioned, despondent underclass that are not being represented by that political system. So voting for it is tacit complicity with that system, and that's not something I'm offering up.
Well, why don't you change it then?
I'm trying to.
Well, why don't you start by voting?
I don't think it works. People have voted already, and that's what's created the current paradigm.
When did you last vote?
Never.
You've never, ever voted?
No. Do you think that's really bad?
So you struck an attitude, what, before the age of 18?
Well, I was busy being a drug addict at that point because I come from the kind of social conditions that are exacerbated by an indifferent system that really just administrates for large corporations and ignores the population that it was voted in to serve.
You're blaming the political class for the fact you had a drug problem?
No. I'm saying I was part of a social and economic class that is underserved by the current political system, and drug addiction is one of the problems it creates when you have huge, underserved, impoverished populations. People get drug problems and also don't feel like they want to engage with the current political system because they see that it doesn't work for them. They see that it makes no difference. They see that they're not served.
Well, of I course say it that doesn't apathy, work for them if they don't bother to vote.
Jeremy, my darling, I'm not saying that the apathy doesn't come from us, the people. The apathy comes from the politicians. They are apathetic to our needs. They're only interested in servicing the needs of corporations. Look at what, ain't the Tories going to court and to taking the EU to court because they're trying to curtail bank bonuses? Is that what's happening at the moment in our country? It is, isn't it?
Yeah, there is.
So what am I going to tune in for that?
You don't believe in democracy. You want a revolution, don't you?
The planet is being destroyed. We are creating an underclass. We are exploiting poor people all over the world. And the genuine, legitimate problems of the people are not being addressed by our political class.
All of those things may be true.
They are true.
But you took... I wouldn't argue with you about many of them.
Well, how come I feel so cross with you? It can't just be because of that beard. It's gorgeous.
It's possibly because...
And if the Daily Mail don't want it, I do. I'm against them. Grow it longer. Tangle it into your armpit hair.
You are a very trivial man.
What, do you think I am trivial?
Yes.
A minute ago, you were having a go at me because I want a revolution. Now
no,
I'm trivial.
I'm not having a go at you because you want a revolution. Many people want a revolution, but I'm asking you what it will be like.
Well, I think what it won't be like is a huge disparity between rich and poor, where 300 Americans have the same amount of wealth as the 85 million poorest Americans, where there is an exploited and underserved underclass that are being continually ignored, where welfare is slashed while Cameron and Osborne go to court to defend the rights of bankers to continue receiving their bonuses.
That's all I'm saying.
What's the scheme? That's all I'm asking. What's the scheme? You talk vaguely about revolution. What is it?
I think a socialist egalitarian system based on the massive redistribution of wealth, heavy taxation of corporations and massive responsibility for energy companies and any company that's exploiting the environment. I think they should be... I think the very concept of profit should be hugely reduced. Okay. David Cameron says profit isn't a dirty word. I say profit is a filthy word, because wherever there is profit, there is also deficit. And this system currently doesn't address these ideas. And so why would anyone vote for it? Why would anyone be interested in
it? Who would levy these taxes?
I think we do need to, there needs to be a centralised administrative system, but built
on... government.
Needs to be a government.
Well, we might maybe call it something else. Call them, like, the admin bods, right, so they don't get
ahead of themselves. And how would they be chosen?
Jeremy, don't ask me to sit here in an interview with you in a bloody hotel room and devise a global utopian system. I'm merely pointing out that the
You're
current...
You're calling for revolution.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. I'm calling for change. I'm calling for genuine alternatives. I say when there is a genuine alternative, a genuine option, then vote for that. But until then, don't bother. Why pretend? Why be complicit in this ridiculous illusion?
Because by the time somebody comes along, you might think it worth voting for, it may be too late.
I don't think so, because the time is now. These movements are already occurring. It's happening everywhere. We're in a time where communication is instantaneous and there are communities all over the world. The Occupy movement made a difference, even if only in that it introduced to the popular public lexicon the idea of the 1% versus the 99%. People for the first time in a generation are aware of massive corporate and economic exploitation. These things are not nonsense. And these subjects are not being addressed. No one's doing anything about tax havens. No one's doing anything about their political affiliations and financial affiliations of the Conservative Party. So until people start addressing things that are actually real, why wouldn't I be facetious? Why would I take it seriously? Why would I encourage a constituency of young people that are absolutely indifferent to vote? Why would we? Aren't you bored? Aren't you more bored than anyone? Ain't you been talking to them year after year, listening to their lies, their nonsense? Then it's this one gets in, then it's that one getting in. But the problem continues. Why are we going to continue to contribute to this facade?
I'm surprised you can be facetious when you're that angry about it.
Yeah, I am angry. I am angry. Because for me, it's real. Because for me, it's not just some peripheral thing that I turn up once in a while to a church fete for. For me, this is what I come from. This is what I care about.
Do you see any hope?
Remember that? Yeah, totally. There's going to be a revolution. It's totally going to happen. I don't, I ain't got a flicker of doubt. This is the end. This is time to wake up. I remember I see you in that program where you look at your ancestors and you saw that while your grandmother had to brass herself or got fucked over by the aristocrats who ran her gaff, you cried because you knew that it was unfair and unjust. And that was, what was that, a century ago? That's happening to people now. I just come from a woman who's being treated like that. I've just been talking to a woman today who's being treated like that. So if we can engage that feeling, instead of some moment of lachrymose sentimentality trotted out on the TV for people to pour over emotional porn, if we can engage that feeling and change things, why wouldn't we? Why is that naive? Why is that not my right because I'm an actor? I mean, I've taken the right. I don't need the right from you. I don't need the right from anybody. I'm taking it.
Russell Brand.